we're ready to begin our story about Greta. Now, Greta lived in a little village up in Nova Scotia, close to the coast. The LaHab River came down and met the Atlantic Ocean, and her farm, I should say, wasn't in the village. It was 3 miles west of the village. But her husband died, and she had a little boy. So it was just Greta and her little boy living on the farm. But Greta couldn't do everything the farm needed. Year after year, the fences got worse. The barn needed repair. She couldn't do these things. The crops that the farm used to raise grew smaller and smaller, and it was harder and harder for her to provide for herself and her son. And then she got a bright idea. She knew that over in the village, 3 miles away on the west side of the LaHab River, were stores. And every year, this big fleet of ships and boats that circulated in the Atlantic coast off of the Nova Scotia coastline came into town and got stores, purchased stores of equipment and food and things they would need on their vessels for the coming year. And one of the things they all needed were brooms. And she could make these brooms. These were special kinds of brooms that these fishing boats used maybe 100 years or so ago. And they were made out of birch. And so what she decided to do was to cut these birch trees, so to speak, that were about 4 inches wide, and she would make brooms and take them to the village and sell the brooms. And so after her chores were done during the day and the supper was over and the little boy was in bed, she went out to the barn, lit a fire in the rusty tin stove she had out there, lit the lantern, and then started with her jackknife to make the broom out of the birch branch or tree that she had. And it was like 4 feet long, and she would get a sliver, maybe an inch or so wide, a sliver, and bring the jackknife all the way down to about 8 inches from the other end, and then start, make another sliver, and work her way around and around that birch tree or large limb until it was only maybe 1 or 2 inches wide. So she had all of these slivers, and then she pulled them back, attached them to the handle with a strong fishing wire, chopped off one end, and somehow, if you can imagine in your mind, this made a bushy brush, a durable bushy brush they could use on the vessels. Well, at first, this was very hard on her hands, and she got blisters on her hands. She tried using gloves. Gloves just were awkward. She couldn't use those. Finally, she found some strips of linen that she wrapped around her hands to protect her hands until they firmed up and became more sturdy, and she could make her birch brooms. And in a good night, by midnight, she would have 4 or 5 of them made. She started this the early part of the winter, because it was in the early spring that the fishing vessels would come in and buy their stores of equipment. And so by the end of January, she had 240 birch brooms made, and she decided it was time to take them and sell them. So early on a chilly morning, in early February, she got out old Judy. Judy was her mare, hitched Judy up to the sleigh, put all 240 brooms onto the sleigh and her son, and off they went, 3 miles to her nearest neighbor who was going to watch her son. So she dropped her son off, and then she and Judy and the sleigh continued on to the village. It was a beautiful day. She loved it. I mean, the snow was all about, the bells on the harness were ringing, and the crunch of the snow under the runners of the sleigh. It was a nice morning and a nice experience. When by the time she got to West LaHab, she went into the shop and told the shopkeeper what she had to sell. He said, "Oh, I'm sorry, I already have all I need. I don't need any more birch brooms." And he said, "But if you go across the river to the east side and down 3 more miles to the next village, they probably will buy your brooms. And so she looked, and it was, and he said, teams have been coming across the river. It's frozen solid. You won't have any problems. And it's only half mile across. So a half mile across the river, then 3 miles down on the east side to another village. And that's exactly what she did. Good old Judy took her across the river and down the river shoreline, 3 miles to the next village on the east side, East LaHab. And she pulled up to the shop and was weary and tired from the long trip, but eagerly she went up the steps and into the shop and explained to the shop owner what she had. And he just listened and then shook his head and said, I'm sorry, everyone has been selling birch brooms. I have more than I need. I can't buy your birch brooms. Now she was really, really disappointed. In the shop around the stove were a half dozen fishermen and captains of their vessels talking about their plans for the future, but they noticed Greta coming in. They noticed her old worn coat that she wore that was really too thin for the weather that was outside. They noticed her cap that was hand woven from wool that she had made herself, or that she had put together herself. They noticed her old worn boots. And also inside her gray mittens, her fingers were twitching and crossing nervously because she was anxious about what was being said by the shopkeeper. And when the shopkeeper said, I'm sorry, I can't buy your brooms, one of the captains spoke up quietly and said, buy those brooms or we will. And so the shopkeeper sent his clerk out to the sleigh, brought in the 240 brooms, counted them out and said, all right, 240 brooms at 25 cents. And then another fisherman spoke up, 40 cents a broom. So he counted it out, 40 cents a broom. She got $96 from all of her brooms. Now, she was so thankful. And she thanked the owner, and then she thanked the captains as she walked by. And one of the captains spoke up and said, be smart about driving home, ma'am. It looks like snow is coming. And so when she stepped outside, sure enough, the sunlight was not as bright. There was a kind of an uneasy wind passing through, and the clouds were coming in. But she got into her sleigh with good old Judy, and they made their way 3 miles back upriver to where the crossing point was to go across to the other village on the west side of the river. But as she made her way up, snow did start to fall, and it was biting on her cheek. It was cold and hard, but she made her way up to the crossing point, and as she crossed the river, she could follow the tracks that the other teams had left crossing the river, but the snow began to fall even harder. And as they were crossing this half mile, it was falling so hard that she couldn't see past the ears of Judy, and she didn't know which way to go. And the only thing she could do was let Judy take the lead. And so she loosened the reins and let Judy find her way across the river. But she began to pray in earnest. Now, I should tell you that she was praying before she left. She was a God-fearing woman, and she was doing her best to raise her boy, just she and her boy there on the farm. And so she was praying now more in earnest because the snow really was coming in, and she couldn't see past the ears of the horse. And so she let Judy find her way, and Judy kept on going and kept on going, but it seemed to take a long time to get across the river. But she couldn't tell Judy what else to do, so she just let Judy go, hoping and praying that Judy knew where she was going. Then, through the snow, she saw something huge there, but then there were three long, straight things in her vision. She thought, oh, good, it's trees. We've reached across. We've made our way across, and we're on the other side. But the closer she got, she realized, no, those aren't trees. Those are the masts of a ship that's moored. Have we reached the We've been going the wrong way. Judy's lost. Instead of going upriver, we've been going downriver. Now we must be near the ocean itself, near the mouth of the river. And sure enough, what she saw was a huge ship that had been moored in the river for the winter. And she's thinking, oh no, I don't know if I'm close to the ocean or not. And I can't remember if when they moor their ships, if they put the bow upriver or downriver or sideways. I don't know where I'm at, but the only thing I know to do is pray and press on. And so she got down off of the sleigh, took the bridle in her hand, and realized that the wind was coming on her right cheek. So she thought, if I just keep the wind on my right cheek, that will prevent me from going in circles and just being furthermore lost. And so she kept the wind on her right cheek, took a hold of the bridle, and just started going. Of course, she couldn't see where she was going. And she started to, her hands and her legs and arms, she began to feel numb. This snow that it had been biting her and coming from all directions into her face and around her now felt really soft and gentle. And she thought, oh, this is nice snow. I would just like to rest in this snow. This is soft snow. But then she thought of her son, and she had a picture of her son looking out the window, anxiously looking for Mom to return, and she thought, no, I can't lay down in the snow. I've got to press on and keep going. My son is waiting for me. You know what? She loved her son, and she didn't want to disappoint her son and wait, even though her mind wasn't that clear, thinking, if I just take a nap, I'll be okay. She knew she had to press on to get home for her son. And so she kept going. And she was getting colder and had to fight drowsiness, had to fight the idea, if I could just rest a little bit, I'll be all right. And then she came to something that was all black. And it was this huge thing of blackness in front of her. And she thought, what is this? And the closer she got, she realized it was water. And she thought, now I really am done for. Now we have reached the real mouth of the river, and this is the ocean that I'm in. It's either that, or it's we're at a stream or the river where the, and it's ice. If water is overflowing the ice. And I won't know. There's no way to know unless I step into the water and find out if there's ice underneath it. And so, even though she was cold and freezing anyway, she wrapped the reins around her hand, pulled Judy as close to the shore as she could, and put one foot in. It came up, the cold water came up to her ankle, nothing, came up halfway up her leg, nothing, to her knee, and then she lost her balance and fell into the water, but as she went in, her feet found the ice. It was ice underneath. She wasn't at the ocean. This is a true story, by the way. I meant to tell you at the beginning. And so she knew that she wasn't at the ocean, that this was, that if she went across it, she would get to the other side of the river, even though this seemed to be, well, she couldn't tell, but it turned out it wasn't that far across till they reached the other bank. But she had to pull Judy down into it. Judy wouldn't go, but she pulled her, and Judy slipped and came on down. And they made their way across this stream or water to the other side. And on the other side, up the bank they went, they found a fence. And she followed the fence until it led to a home that had a light in it. And so she was able to get warm. And Judy, poor Judy, was exhausted, was cared for by the people at this home. And the reason I'm telling you this story is because it was love that kept Greta going and kept her moving through the snowstorm. It kept her even making these birch brooms in the first place to provide for her son. But it was love that did this. If she had her own way, she would have rested in the snow taken a little rest in the snow, but it was love for her son that kept her moving, kept her pressing forward, and it was her prayers to our Heavenly Father that helped her find the way out and to help at this farmhouse. And she eventually made her way home to her son. And, and I meant to tell you that this $96, she had no purse to put it in. She had a big safety pin, and she pinned it to the hem of her skirt. And when she got to the farmhouse, she checked the hem of her skirt, and it was still there. So God had protected her and the funds that she had tried to so hard to obtain for her family, and protected good old Judy, and they made it back to their farm eventually. But God is good. And love, you see, 1 Corinthians 13:13 tells us there are some good things that God wants us to have, faith and hope, but love is the best of them all. And Ash is going to read 1 Corinthians 13:13 for us.
And now abide faith, hope, charity, these three, but the greatest of these is charity.
Thank you, Ashley, and thank you.